Well, today my conversation is with Lieutenant Colonel Dan Hampton. He's retired now, but he flew, check this out, 151 combat missions during his 20 years of service in the U.S. Marine Corps. He received the Purple Heart, 4 Distinguished Flying Crosses with Valor, 8 Air Medals with Valor. There's a bunch more too. And he's a graduate of USN Top Gun School, a real life Tom Cruise and a real life hero. Thank you so much for talking with me here today.
Good morning, Kim. And I was not a Marine. I was in the Air Force.
Oh, thank you so much. Research, I do as much as I can. And there's, I guess, some bad news out there, right?
No. It's okay. You do a lot of work. I understand. I get confused sometimes.
Okay, so you've got this book out here, Valor, and it's about a guy by the name of Bill Harris. And man, talk about a real life hero, Bill, and the things he went through. First of all, how did you learn about Bill Harris?
I learned about Bill Harris a few years ago. I was researching the book that came out before this one. It was called Vengeance, and it took place on Guadalcanal largely. And I ran across a Marine general named Field Harris. And when I was just browsing around looking at him, because I go off on tangents when I research, I found out that he had a son who was also a Marine officer fighting in the Pacific. And those sorts of stories about, you know, brothers or fathers and sons that are in the same conflicts always kind of intrigued me. I made a note about it and then forgot about it until after Vengeance was finished. And when the publishers approached me for an idea for a new book, I said, well, what about this? And the more I dug into it, the more fascinating the story became, as you'll see when you read Valor.
For sure. And you met his daughter, right? Who also was quite helpful.
Oh, she was magnificent. Her name's Katie. She's the little girl, incidentally, on the cover, pictured on the cover in between Bill and his wife.
Oh, there.
And she had, as a writer, it was just a dream. She had a 1,500-page manuscript that her father wrote. Yeah, you know, guys handle combat afterwards in different ways, and plainly one way he handled it was just to write it all down and get it off his chest. And from a writing standpoint, it was just a gold mine, because all the dialogue, the first person stuff, the thoughts that are in this book, it comes from Bill Harris.
Wow. And he lived quite the life. He had a pivotal thing happen to him when he was 25 years old. Talk about the relationship with his dad and kind of leading up to that.
Well, he was captured by the Japanese on Corregidor. When the army surrendered, they surrendered everybody, including the Marines. And Bill was beaten to quite literally within an inch of his life by the Japanese guards. And when he recovered, when he came to and got his strength back enough, he knew he'd never have a better chance to escape. And he absolutely was not going to be a POW. So he was going to get back into the war, escape from this, or he was going to die trying. And that's what Valor is generally about. But in it, you learn about his father. You see his father's points of view from certain points, you know, certain times in the story, his mother, which is very interesting. Some of the social stuff going on, you know, in World War II, right as it began, and how people felt about things. And then you meet his future wife, a beautiful young woman named Jan. And all of these people came alive through the manuscript that I got to read, and through all their personal letters that Katie was kind enough to give me.
If you had to describe Bill Harris, how would you describe him as a person? And maybe, you know, I'm sure you did a ton of research. How did people describe him?
I would describe him as resilient, very also defiant. Resilient and defiant are two great adjectives to describe Bill Harris. He never gave up. You know, some people just don't have it in them to give up, and he never did. Even if it was going to kill him, he wasn't going to give up. So there are those two qualities. Other people saw him much the same way. You know, he was a military officer. He was a Marine. Men counted on him. You know, he was a good combat leader. He took care of his guys to the extent that he could. I think everybody looked up to him and would have followed him anywhere.
Yeah, and when you talk about defiance, like you were describing it now, it reminds me again of the whole Ukraine, you know, Russia thing that's going on, because like, I just so admire and respect those Ukrainians that it's like, that's how much their freedom means to them, right? You have to, what do you need when you're fighting an enemy like that?
That's a good parallel to what, you know, to what went on, you know, back when in Bill's story. With the Ukraine, you know, the defiance and resilience are going to see them through this, I think. That and a lot of weapons from us.
Yeah.
Defiance and resilience are fine all by themselves, but you've got to have a little material support as well. However, if you have all the material in the world, but you don't have that spirit in you, you're very likely going to lose. So you need a combination of both of them. And that's very clearly illustrated with what's going on in the Ukraine. They're not going to give up. They're not going to surrender to the Russians. And, you know, who could blame them? The Russians are absolutely behaving like barbarians.
Yeah.
And I was trained to fight them way back when they were the Soviet Union. And we were never concerned about them for precisely the reasons that have been revealed over the last 70 something days. You know, they're really not that good. And on top of that, they're barbaric and cruel.
Yeah. And, you know, in your life, I mean, like you look at your life, just describing what you're describing now, it's like your life is an action adventure. How difficult or how different was it to try to act? Like, is it boring? Like, are your days boring now? And is that maybe a good thing?
Well, I wouldn't call them boring. I have a couple of kids, so of course it's not boring. But it's not the I know what you mean. It's not the constant adrenaline rush that you get from flying fighters. And after I retired, I went into the private military world for a while. And that certainly wasn't boring. I'm very happy most days to sit here in my study and write books. Sometimes I miss the jazz and the excitement, but you know, you gotta know when to stop and gotta know when to bow out. And I think it was my time.
How can we help like the men and women that are returning? Cause I can't even imagine going from even just like your short-term service, right? To coming back and having seen everything that you, like, how can we as a society help them acclimate, help them like try to ease back in as easy as possible?
Well, I'm not sure there's anything anybody can do other than perhaps be a little tolerant and understanding. I'm not saying give everybody a free pass just because they've deployed overseas, because that's not right. And you have to remember that the majority of people that do deploy somewhere never see combat. So you have to kind of weigh with, you know, what they're saying with what's real and what isn't. That being said, a little tolerance and understanding is always helpful. It's worse now, believe it or not, I think, than it was in Bill's day, because it took so long to get from place to place. You know, it would have taken him under normal circumstances a good month to 6 weeks to get back from the South Pacific to where he needed to go. Now you could do it in a matter of hours. When I was private military contractor, it's even faster because you're basically a civilian. And when you leave, you catch a flight and you're gone. So 24, 36 hours after being in the middle of something nasty, you're stepping off the plane in Chicago or Dallas, you know, and music's playing and there's a Starbucks and you're around normal people again.
That's it's a little disorienting. That would seem just so surreal. Like it's almost like a parallel. It feels like a parallel universe, right?
That's a good way to put it. It is a little surreal and people deal with it different ways. I was always, as a pilot, I was good at compartmentalizing, and that's the way I dealt with it.
Yeah. And you know, I was reading about you. You were, I know where I was. I remember when it happened, you know, September 11, 2001. Where were you?
We had just come back from a routine rotation to the Middle East. And that was actually our first day after our 2 week break, first day back flying, just doing training missions. And I was looking forward to flying over green instead of brown and not carrying weapons on the airplane and just going out and flying and doing what we do. And that was the morning the planes hit the Twin Towers. And they immediately brought us all back, armed up the planes and sent us overhead different cities up and down the East Coast to make sure all the airliners really landed at the airport and didn't crash into any more buildings. So that's how I spent September 11th and the next 4 or 5 days.
When you were in those skies flying, like, what did you, What did you see? What did you see looking down? What did you see around you?
You mean on September 11th here? Oh, not much. And it got very quiet very, very quickly. I mean, on a normal day, there's over, 10,000 flights, commercial flights. And there's a lot of talking on the radio, a lot of chatter. It's not noisy, but it's just busy. And it slowly, as time went on, got quieter and quieter, because before long, the only people flying were the fighter pilots and the tankers that were giving us gas. So it was a little bit eerie, you know, to be like that. And everybody was a bit unsettled. Nobody really knew what was happening, what was going on. And we were asked to do a flyby over downtown Atlanta just to raise everybody's spirits, which we did, which was kind of fun. But it was really a strange day, wasn't it? And more so for us, because it wasn't anywhere close to what it normally was when we flew.
Yeah. I mean, I can't imagine like being in the air and the sky at that time and getting that close to, you know, ground zero and just trying to, nobody knew. Nobody quite knew, because it was kind of really a first, wasn't it?
Yeah. And, it, you know,
we had
from
the Oklahoma
point of
City
view,
bombing, but something like this was a little different.
Well, and nobody really knew, right? Were those the only planes or not? It turns out they weren't, but the others were stopped. And, you know, for my part, I felt guilty, because I was a military officer and I regarded it as my responsibility to protect the United States. We're not used to having people attack us here.
Right.
You know, we always go overseas to other people's countries to fight. We're not used to it here. And it really kind of brought me up short. Now, there wasn't anything we could have done to have prevented that. Yeah. But still, you know, it makes you feel, it made us feel a little bit guilty for a short time while all that was, happening. And then of course it got sorted out and people came to understand what had happened. And then we did something about it in 2003.
You know, Deanna, I only have you for a couple more minutes, but I'm curious, what made you get into the military and stay in it 20 years?
Well, it wasn't intentional. I went to school the first time to be an architect. My first degree was in architecture, and I wanted to wear cloth ties and wear pleated pants and design beautiful buildings. My father had been a Marine fighter pilot, and flying kind of ran in the family. I started flying when I was 15. It was one of those things that an epiphany, if you will. When I was halfway through college, I realized that flying jet fighters, if I could get to that point, would be a lot more exciting than designing buildings. So that's what I did. And then the timing never worked out for me to get out. I went through some special schools that added commitments. And by the time I could get out, I was already halfway through 20 and I just stayed. I couldn't think of anything, you know, else I'd rather do. This is the military is the only place where you can fly a fighter jet. You know, you can't get out and go do it on the side. And it was the only time in my life I'd be able to do it. And I was grateful for the opportunity.
Yes. And then you did a, after I did my research, I'm wondering if it really happened. Did you do an ancestry DNA test or find out like you're related to all these famous people in the military?
Oh yeah. No, that's a well-known family, history. The Higginbothams, the Bartletts, the Hamptons, you can find them, you know, if you look them up. It's a long and interesting, sometimes sordid history, but I'm proud of my family.
I love it. The book Valor right here. And let me remind you of this. What do you want the reader to take away from this book?
Hope and inspiration to realize that Bill had resilience and defiance. And I think most Americans, given the right time and opportunity, would have the same. So come along on his journey and find out what happened and be a little bit inspired. We all need that today.
Yeah, it's an action adventure, but it's a true story, which is really, really even more special. Hey,
makes
Dan, where
better,
can people reach
it?
Out to you?
I have a Dan Hampton author Facebook page. I don't keep a website anymore. I will respond if people have comments. I always welcome it. It may take me a while, but I will answer them. So please, if you have a comment or a question especially, feel free to get a hold of me there.
I wore my World War II shell pin. Soldiers would send these home to their girls.
Right.
and one survived. So anyway, have a great one. It was really nice talking to you today.
Thank you very much. It was a pleasure.
Take care, Dan.